Welcome to Your 20-Minute Podcast with David Brower, where we do our best to give you useful information in 20 minutes or less. Now, here's your host, five-time Voice Arts Awards nominee, David Brower.
Thanks, Alan. This is David Brower with your 20-Minute Podcast. Our special guest today from New York City is Maestro Roger Nierenberg from New York. As I said, he made his debut at the Avery Fisher with the Pro Art Chorale and Orchestra. And he's been conducting all over the country and including recording with the London Philharmonic, and has also worked with most renowned solo artists and composers of our time. But along the way, he figured out a way to turn magical, beautiful music to help businesses. Maestro, welcome to the show. How are you?
Hi, David. Delighted to be here.
Thank you so much. My pleasure indeed. So let's talk about your music first and foremost. Where and when did music become part of your life, and how did all that transpire?
I think I was about 8 or 9 years old when I discovered the Beethoven symphonies, mm-hmm. and that really changed my life. I thought to myself, I don't know what this is, but whatever it is, that's what I want to be. That's what I want to do.
Wow, that's terrific. And then where did that epiphany, for lack of a better term, at such a young age, how did that grow? Where did that progress? Where did it take you?
It's not a young age for musicians. So a lot of musicians get an earlier start than that. And I wanted to write music. That was, as soon as I could read music, I wanted to write it.
Wow.
And nobody stopped me, so I did. And eventually, when I was in junior high school, I started studying with a composer. The other thing that I did was I played in orchestras, and I just there was this electric thrill that passed through me during the music, and it was very difficult for me to stay seated. it seemed like the most natural thing to want to conduct, to express that through my body.
Oh my gosh, I just got huge goosebumps on that story. That is fabulous how things just take over your life and you open up and accept them and just run with it.
Well, it's not really, actually not that unusual a story in the world of music.
Okay.
Because there are tons of people who want the same thing, who want to become conductors.
But how do they get in their own way? How do they open it up?
There are just very few places. It's one of the most competitive careers that you can have.
Okay.
And so the ranks get thinned out, and then I think every conductor is a kind of musical entrepreneur,
mm-hmm.
and constantly creating things out of nothing. And that was certainly true of me.
Well, that makes sense. You've conducted with over 90 different orchestras and been before lots of different organizations in a couple of dozen countries, and all of that kind of. I mean, as quickly and as passionately as music entered your life at a young age, my description, then when did the idea of music being a metaphor to get into business leadership, how did that come about?
Well, it's a very interesting question, the way you phrase it. It was an accident, really. From kind of my composing days, I knew what it was to have a musical idea and to kind of... to sniff it out, and I just had this idea that when music was presented in a way, in a metaphorical way, representing something else,
mm-hmm.
that actually it made the music sound more beautiful. What I really wanted to do was I was experimenting about ways to get more people interested in music, to build the orchestra for symphony orchestras, and I just kind of pulled together many different aspects of my career and created this learning experience. And when I launched it, I was astonished with its effect. And especially business organizations just found such value in it. Whereas what I was looking for was building audience, but what they were looking for was ways of becoming more effective. And they found this just very, very meaningful and long lasting. And then I started getting invitations for business organizations, and it kind of created a second career for myself.
Wow. And it's called the music paradigm.
That's what it's called. Exactly.
Yeah. And so it just kind of evolved organically, it sounds like. Here it is. Let's take another walk through music in a totally different way. What a fascinating ride you've been on.
Well, I've always been one to follow my inspiration, and
yeah,
that's exactly what I did, and that's how it brought me here.
That makes sense. That makes sense. In this world of immediate gratification and people going 120 miles an hour and looking over both shoulders and forgetting to breathe from time to time, we all get so wrapped up in different things, so many things, that oftentimes we don't stop long enough to actually take a breath and see things that are right in front of us. And you've had the blessing to be able to do that your entire life, it sounds like.
Well, it's very astute the way you put it, because there's so much instant gratification, and so much of the world in which we live, and the media world that we live, mm-hmm. is based on that.
Yeah.
You know, you can have what you want, get it your way, and get it when you want it and how you want it. And it makes you almost lose faith in the possibility of getting people to sit down for longer periods of time and to focus on something.
Yeah.
But in the sessions that I do, that's what happens. And it's very affirming, because it's not a strain for people, and people get very absorbed. The sessions are extremely absorbing, and you can hear a pin drop. And part of it is the drama of seating people inside the orchestra, mm-hmm. amongst the musicians, and then doing a kind of an improvised presentation, which meaning that it's not scripted, that it's very real. The orchestra doesn't know what they're going to be asked to do,
mm-hmm.
And so it's just it really holds people's attention. It keeps them focused, and I think that's a great thing, because the companies that engage me are all trying to bring about some kind of change in their organization, and some kind of learning, especially of skills, but also, you know, learning about what the culture could be and in the organization. And for that kind of learning, it requires a sort of a focus.
So, absolutely.
I think it's very inspiring that so many different kinds of audiences, you know, from bankers to salespeople, and you know, just every walk of life, they've been through it. Nurses and surgeons and I'm trying to think of the most improbable ones. Football referees from the Big Ten football conference.
Wow!
They've all participated in my sessions, and with basically the same effect, that their attention is captured. And they start to ponder about the work that they do, and the powers that they have of which they weren't aware,
mm-hmm.
The effect of their behaviors, at the same time that it's coming to them through beautiful symphonic music. It sounds too good to be true, doesn't it?
Well, it does. And what fascinates, I was just at my granddaughter's concert the other night. She plays in the orchestra, and they had the choir and all the strings, you know. I mean, it was just, oh my God, you could hear a pin drop in there, well, because it was so beautiful. But
well,
music,
lucky girl to have that experience.
Oh my gosh. Absolutely right. And so, oh, here goes my goosebumps again. I'm sorry. But anyway, it's fascinating to me the energy that you feel from music that is totally unexpected, unless you've been exposed to it, obviously, for a long time. But when you are in front of, sitting with, adjacent to some kind of beautiful music, as you describe and as you prepare and perform, the energy just hits you unbelievably, and you have no idea it's coming.
Well, it should be that way.
Yeah.
But what struck me is how many people are kind of barred from that experience through their own inhibitions.
Mm-hmm.
They're a little bit scared of this kind of music. They don't feel comfortable with it, and if they come into a concert hall, they're not sure exactly what they're supposed to do. They don't
sure.
know when to clap. You know, it's just that for many people, it's a kind of uptight experience, and that I was trying to create a different environment. So I was thinking, if I really want to get people in an open state, I have to change the subject from music. I want the music to be about something else. And I thought, well, what do people really care about in our time,
mm-hmm.
you know, as it is?
Yeah.
And I think everybody's concerned about their careers. I think that's the thing that people really care about. So I made it about people's careers, and the music comes as a way of a kind of a demonstration, a kind of manifestation of the forces that are at work in making organizations work and making people successful. And while their minds are fascinated by that, it leaves them open to actually hearing the music in a way that they've never heard it before. And that's what many people say. They say, I've overheard this remark. This is, I never knew that I liked Beethoven.
Yeah, absolutely brilliant, Maestro. My gosh, absolutely brilliant to be able to take what you love, what you're passionate about, what you've been doing all your life, and be able to convert that into a learning experience for businesses for a couple of reasons. Obviously, one, to expose them to the music in a comfortable way rather than, oh my God, what is that I'm listening to? And have the music support the learning experience and open up their mind to what you're bringing to them and just get rid of the clutter and go, okay, Maestro, here you go. My brain's all yours.
Well, mind you, business organizations are not about to spend their money and, more importantly, their time mm-hmm. on stuff just to so that their people can listen to music.
Correct.
They guard that time, those resources, very carefully. So they're not going to engage anybody unless there's this business value to be had. But the fact is that a lot of business organizations are in a kind of a race against change because the world is changing. Mm-hmm. The way business is done, and there are so many changes that are going on. Everybody knows that the change is getting faster and faster, and that right. organizations, the bigger they are, the slower they are to adapt. And so they bring themselves together periodically to align around, this is our strategy, this is what we're going to do.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that workforces are kind of I wouldn't say they're suspicious, but they're skeptical about these kinds of messages. And they think that the leadership, that they're far removed from the work, that they don't really have an idea of what's really going on, that
right.
the workers are the ones who really know what's going on. And so there's a resistance to receiving messages. And it just was a kind of a very happy coincidence that what I was doing in order to build audiences was extremely effective in penetrating through that resistance and getting people not only to understand what their leadership was trying to bring about, but also to embrace it and to want to be part of it.
Wow.
And I think that's the reason that it's been successful. So successful is because a lot, in organizations, it's hard to get messages across.
You bet.
To all the different people who work there. When people don't see the big picture about what they're doing, they're kind of, focused on their particular role. And mm-hmm. so a lot of messages that come from the top may not make sense to them. So anything that can actually enroll people in what the direction of the company is extremely valuable. And I think that's the reason that organizations continue to engage me.
Absolutely right. And the other part of that, I think, that would be attractive to them is a lot of people are outsourcing, or their employees work from home, or they work in different countries, or what have you. And if there's a way to bring all the employees into this kind of environment, that would be absolutely incredible, because then you have the out-of-office workers who finally see faces that they've been talking to and start to have relationships, and then they all get on the same music merry-go-round, if you will. And wow, I'm fascinated by that.
Yeah. Well, of course, you're right about that, that's a big aspect of why they bring their people together, to
mm-hmm.
to foster a sense of community.
Mm-hmm.
But this exercise, the music paradigm, is a kind of a game. It's a learning thing, but it feels like a game. But it's not a silly game. And then you have the professional musicians who are there. And mind you, it's unscripted, and they don't know what's going to happen. So they're experiencing it too at the same time. And for the executives to be watching another workforce that is, and I create these role plays that challenge the musicians in ways that are very similar to the way the company employees are challenged. Mm-hmm. So they get fascinated in watching this other workforce handle the kinds of challenges that they do. And before long, listening to the orchestra becomes kind of like, for them, looking in the mirror.
Wow.
But it's not a normal mirror, because in it, everything happens much faster than in real life. In music, things get compressed together.
Right.
And they happen so quickly that there's no confusion about cause and effect. In real life, you might take an action, a dysfunctional action, you know, mm-hmm. without realizing it. You may not see the result of that for months. And by the time you do it, it's very hard to connect that to the effect to the cause.
Yeah.
But in music, it's so instantaneous that there's no question about it. And so in the musical metaphor, it's much easier to connect the dots about behavior and the effect that it has.
And the other part of that, I think, which is another one of the 127 different fascinating things about this approach, is you mentioned time, and time becomes irrelevant. I mean, you're in the moment, you're in the music, you're engaged fully, and you're not looking at a clock or worrying about going to lunch.
I think you're right that you enter into a different domain. You enter into the domain of, you know, it's the arts, and it's like entering into kind of a myth. It's a fantasy land in which life is represented through musical activity. And that becomes fascinating. It becomes arresting.
Absolutely.
And the fact that you come out of it with many practical lessons about yourself and powers that you have but had not realized, and behaviors that of your own that you begin to realize the implications of them, both positive and negative. So it's there are so many things going on at once. That's why it's kind of difficult to explain to people what happens.
We only got a couple of minutes left, so I want to recap just a couple of things. Your programs are customized to meet the needs of businesses. You've got a great testimonial here from Dr. Ronald Sugar, the chairman, CEO, president of Northrop Grumman Corporation. This was probably the single most effective group experience they've ever had in a business management offsite. That's a big testimony from a big company and carries a lot of weight with other businesses. So your referrals have to be just amazing.
I don't know what to say about that. Of course, I remember that session that I did for Dr. Sugar and the executives at Northrop Grumman. And the people who were there, they have subsequently engaged me for other sessions as their careers moved on to other organizations. And then they called me up just last week. I was with some of the people who were there at Northrop Grumman.
Wow, fascinating. And there's also a wonderful book. It's called Maestro, A Surprising Story About Leading by Listening. And you can download a free sample of it. You can get the book at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, IndieBound, several other places. It's a best-selling book. And one of the testimonies about the book is from Marshall Goldsmith, who is also a best-selling author and a number one leadership coach. And he says, creative genius meets executive challenge in this unique and fascinating tale. Maestro is a must read. And folks, you must go to the website musicparadigm.com and you'll find everything to signal some great epiphanies that you haven't even thought about. Maestro, it's such a gift to be able to talk to you about this program.
Well, speaking of time stopping, I felt like this lasted about 2 minutes, this conversation.
And we're at 20 minutes right now. Yeah. It's a good thing when the time goes by, because we covered a lot of wonderful information. And again, continued success to you. And I hope there's some folks out there that take advantage of the opportunities that you present by going to musicparadigm.com. Maestro, thank you again.
Well, thank you for your wonderful questions.
Listen to your 20-minute podcast with David Brower on the go. Downloads are available on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, any podcast app, and on our website at davidbrowervo.com/your20-minute podcast. Until next time, thank you for listening.